But what I'm doing now is around the community development program. So what's happening in remote communities is we've got Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander workers that are doing work that are paid jobs anywhere in the country, and they're doing it for a welfare payment. So we've got people that are doing fencing, we've got cleaners, we've got shop assistants, we've got people working in schools as teacher aides, and they are being made to do these jobs for a welfare payment. Now, what makes it even worse, and there's a difference when you're looking at your remote community Work for the Dole scheme, CDP, in major cities when you're looking at the Work for the Dole scheme here, is if something happens in a community, someone passes and there might be sorry business, or they need to look after their kids, there's an extremely punitive system in place, and they are finding themselves that if they miss out on an activity, they will get deducted around $56 for missing one activity, over $100 for two activities, and if they miss it a third time, they lose their payments for 8 weeks. Absolutely no money whatsoever coming in for 8 weeks. It not only puts stress on the family, it puts stress on the broader family and the community, and it's basically starving out our communities. When we put in our submission to the Senate inquiry and we're listening to other people, we actually had people get up and they were in tears around what was happening. We had police officers stating that there was an increase in crime, and you know where that increase was? 12 and 13 year olds stealing food. I will get emotional over this, and that's why I'm in the job, because I'm passionate about this issue. We had, only a few weeks ago, there was a bit of a heat wave going on, and we had CDP workers that were forced to work out in WA in 52 degree heats. We had another gentleman last week. All he owned was a pair of shorts and thongs. He was asked to do whippersnipping, and he said, "Can I please get some safety equipment? I don't own long pants or closed-in shoes." The job service provider said to him that that's not their responsibility. They don't have to supply any safety equipment. And if he refused to do the job, he would have his payments cut. He refused to do the job, and he got his settlement cut for 8 weeks. We have people that have medical issues that need to travel 3 days to see a Centrelink approved medical officer, whether it be around mental health, whether it be a disability, just to get a certificate to say that they can't do a particular activity, just to rock up back in the community, and the job service provider doesn't accept it, so they have their pay deducted. If anything comes up, and I'm sure people have experienced this before, I know I have, they have to call Centrelink, so there's nowhere in the community they can go. They actually have to ring a hotline number to let them know that they can't rock up to activity. They can be on the phone for 4 or 5 hours and still not get through. So because they haven't got through, they get their pay deducted. And what we have seen, I was just talking to the lady over here with the cashless debit card. We saw that implemented through the Northern Territory intervention, and we're seeing it being hit really hard in remote communities with CDP workers. So not only are they not having any access to any cash or the ability to save money if by chance they miss an activity and don't get any money coming in, these payments are going on to the cashless welfare card. So if they've got no money coming in and no money on a welfare card, they have no money to buy food, they have no money to buy clothing. So it's quite desperate, I suppose, and a lot of despair out in remote communities, but I am glad to report that we launched the First Nation Workers Alliance in June last year, so not very long ago. And since then we've been visiting remote communities continuously and going back out. And we've set the First Nation Workers Alliance up like a union, and like a union for CDP workers, but it's actually an alliance of both CDP workers, Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander union members, non-Indigenous union members, and union organisations throughout the country that are paying membership fees to be involved in FNWA. and we're starting to see a lot of sparks in the eyes of remote communities by CDP workers and just broader community, because we're actually delivering union skills. You know, how we train our delegates up in our trade unions is how we're training up CDP workers. So last year we took a delegation of CDP workers to Canberra, and they met with the Federal Indigenous Labor Caucus, and they did not hold back. It was beautiful to see. And they actually felt like they were being listened to. And it's really good when you've got advocates within Federal Parliament like Maladira McCarthy, so that's helped our progress in this space as well. But we've got a long way to go. So Scullion, LNP, they won't get rid of CDP. Scullion's come up with this new three-tier system to try and skirt around the issue, but doesn't solve the problem. And we haven't got a hard commitment from ALP today, but that's our job. We'll go lobby ALP and we'll get CDP workers more active on the ground. But definitely, if anyone here wants to get involved, we do have a Facebook page. And one Facebook share can reach up to 7,000 people. And that is an amazing network to have out there. So if you're on Facebook, just a simple share can do great stuff for us. But I'll be around if people have got any more questions, unless they're allowed to ask questions now. I know there's a bit of a time limit.
We might save it for after.
Yep.
But thank you very much.
Yeah, so thank you.